We're going to start this episode by going all the way back to the beginning of the decade and taking a look at the state of video games prior to the release of the NES in 1985. For those of you who weren't around, you might not be aware just how popular video games were in the early 80s. It was a genuine cultural phenomenon. With the introduction of Space Invaders and other popular titles, you suddenly started seeing video games popping up everywhere. Pizza parlors, movie theaters, bowling alleys, and actual video arcades were appearing across the country at amazing speed. Pac-Man, in particular, was everywhere in the early 80s. There were outrageous amounts of Pac-Man merchandise to be found. Pac-Man clothing, dolls, toys, pillows, trading cards, lunch boxes, a Pac-Man cereal, a Pac-Man TV show, books on how to play Pac-Man. The video game itself supposedly sucked up over $1 billion in US quarters. In the world of home video game consoles, there were three major players: the Atari 2600, the Intellivision, and the ColecoVision. By 1981, sales of home consoles and video games exceeded $1 billion a year. In 1982, a song about video games, Buckner Garcia's Pac-Man Fever, became a top 10 hit. And before too long, even established artists like George Clinton or cranky old guys like Lou Reed were releasing video game-themed records. However, in 1983, the industry suddenly took a turn for the worse. The resulting loss of sales is now known as the Great Video Game Crash. There were a number of factors involved in this. One of them was the release of several low-quality games from Atari, which ended up being very high-profile flops. Also, the market was being flooded with inexpensive, unlicensed games from very small companies. Most of these games were not very good, but the sudden influx of a cheap product on the shelf really caused a lot of confusion for consumers. As a result, the biggest player in the home console field, Atari, ended up losing a reported $500 million for the year of 1983. In February of 1984, Mattel sold the rights to the Intellivision to a liquidation company. Later that year, the ColecoVision was discontinued, and the Atari 5200 was discontinued. The companies that had been developing games for home consoles were dropping like flies. In July, Warner sold the rights to the Atari for a mere $240 million. At this point, the media officially declared the video game fad to be over. However, there are a couple things to consider. Even though sales of home consoles had pretty much stalled, video arcades were still popular hangouts for young people. In fact, these years, from 84-85 or so, are considered to be sort of a golden age in arcade games. Additionally, the video game crash didn't really have a very big effect in other countries. In Japan, for example, video games were mostly played on home computers at this point. The Japanese MSX computers and NEC's PC88 computers still continued to sell quite well. So when Nintendo released the Famicom in 1983, they had no reason to believe they were entering a dead industry in Japan. By the beginning of 1985, the Famicom was a resounding success in Japan. Despite this, they couldn't find any US companies interested in actually distributing it within the United States. When Nintendo finally did release the NES in the United States in late 1985, they pretty much had the home video game market all to themselves. Of course, it ended up being a huge success in this country, which proved that Americans did in fact still have an interest in video games. Today we'll be looking at 15 games released for the Famicom in the first half of 1985. One thing we'll notice is that Nintendo adds three major arcade manufacturers to their list of Famicom developers. Also, we'll observe an increasing number of Japan-only releases. In fact, out of the 15 titles we're looking at today, only 5 were released in the United States. So the first title that we're looking at here is Exerion. This is Jaleco's first game for the Famicom. As you can see, this is a vertical shooter. This is actually the first vertical shooter released on the Famicom. The name Jaleco is short for Japanese Leisure Company. They were formed in the early 70s. By 1982, they'd released their first arcade game with the rather unusual name of Naughty Boy. Now, Jellicoe is not really known for having a lot of great arcade titles. In fact, if you think about it, you probably really can't name one of their arcade titles. They were successful enough to stay in business for years and years. They're actually still around, still making games. Now, this game is based on their 1983 arcade shooter. We're looking at the arcade version here. It looks like maybe a little bit better than the Famicom version, but it's still not great graphically. Certainly the Parallax 3D or pseudo 3D backgrounds look better. One thing about the arcade version is that it's very difficult to play. Your ship has like a simulated inertia built into it that makes it steer like a fish. It's really hard to move your ship around. The Famicom version isn't nearly as bad, but this is still not a very playable game compared to something like Xevious, which was the obvious inspiration for this game. It's rather unenjoyable. The ship does not control very well. Your firing options here are really not that pleasant. It's kind of ugly. Most of the enemies, like these, look sort of like the birds from the Phoenix arcade game. In fact, I'd say this is probably the first really mediocre game released on the Famicom. It's certainly one that it's hard to play for more than a few minutes. The constantly changing backgrounds kind of give you a bit of a headache and make you feel a little seasick while you're playing it. So I'm gonna have to give this game a big thumbs down. Here we have Galaga. This is Namco's 1981 sequel to Galaxian. Now, Galaxian hasn't really held up that well over the years, at least in my opinion. Galaga is a much more playable game. What did Namco do to improve on this? Well, first of all, they have better graphics, better sound, and better gameplay. First thing you might notice right away is you can fire more than one shot in the air. This little addition makes the game a lot more fun to play. Sort of one of the frustrating things about Galaxian was simply the fact that you would shoot and sort of have to wait till your laser gets all the way up in the air and hit something. This way you can sort of blast away at things. In these days of modern shoot 'em ups, we pretty much take for granted that you're able to throw out massive amounts of firepower at any given time. But that definitely wasn't the case back in the days of Space Invaders and Galaxian. Probably one of the most well-remembered features of this game is the ability to get two ships at once. Occasionally one of the boss aliens will use a tractor beam to steal the ship. You can then use one of your reserve ships to shoot down that alien, and your stolen ship will come back. Then you have two ships in tandem, enabling you to double your firepower, which of course makes the game even that more fun. Once you've got your second ship in place, you become basically a virtual killing machine. I guess you might say this is probably one of the very first sort of power-ups in an arcade shooter. This Famicom port looks very, very good. I mean, it's virtually identical to the arcade version. I mean, what can you expect from a game that came out in 1981? There's these little bonus rounds here where you sort of simply try to rack up points by shooting all the aliens that come down at you. Galaga is one of those games that makes you realize why Namco was such a powerhouse in the early 80s. It's one of those games that's just super fun to play. The next title we're looking at is Raid on Bungling Bay. Let's go back just a minute and take a look at that title screen. We see this is another Hudsonsoft game, also a port of a Broderbund game, just like Lode Runner. But what's that? That is correct. This is the first game from Will Wright. Will Wright, game designer, entrepreneur, enfant terrible. So we go into this game with perhaps slightly higher expectations. Does it disappoint? Well, no, not entirely. Raid on Bungling Bay is a warfare game. You control a helicopter whose job is to destroy factories. Your base of operations is an aircraft carrier out in the sea. Your object is to fly out to the islands and drop bombs on the factories. Along the way, you'll encounter boats with machine guns, surface-to-air missiles, and enemy jet fighter planes. Out of all the enemies, it's the jet fighters that cause you the most trouble. The controls might take a little getting used to. Left or right on the D-pad will rotate your helicopter, up will accelerate, and down will decelerate. Throughout the game, you might occasionally find yourself using the D-pad in a more conventional fashion, and you'll have to remind yourself of how the control scheme works. This game doesn't seem that difficult at first, but once the jet fighters get alerted and start constantly attacking you, it actually gets quite difficult and a little frustrating at times. Probably the best approach to this game is to fly in cautiously, try to avoid being seen by the enemy patrols and radar. If you are seen, the jet fighters will scramble and suddenly your job will become much more difficult. You can only carry 9 bombs at a time, so you will find yourself frequently returning to the aircraft carrier to get more bombs and to replenish your health. This game almost has elements of later stealth games. The easiest way to get through it is to avoid being seen by the enemies. If the alarm is sounded, you're in trouble. Occasionally, the enemies will turn the table on you and start attacking the aircraft carrier. Now, one thing you might be thinking is, isn't this game a bit violent for the Famicom? I mean, it's one thing to fight with animals, gorillas, aliens, that sort of thing, but by flying a helicopter over cities and dropping bombs, I mean, you're actually probably killing quite a few innocent civilians. Well, according to Broderbund, no, that's actually not what's happening. In fact, you're on a different planet, and you're battling an evil alien empire called the Bungling Empire. By some coincidence, everything on this planet just happens to look like regular Earth factories and buildings and planes and so on and so forth. Broderbund seem to want to have some sort of consistent universe across their games, so a number of their games deal with this Bungling Empire. For example, Lode Runner. Supposedly, the enemies in that game are agents of this very same Bungling Empire that you're battling in Raid on Bungling Bay. So, this game is a rather interesting little game from its time period. Once you get into it, it's actually kind of enjoyable to play. Now, this game apparently originally came with a level editor. It was actually this level editor that Will Wright was fooling around with and realized, building stuff is a lot of fun. Maybe I could do an entire game based around building cities. So if nothing else, fool around with the level editor. Maybe you yourself will also get a gazillion dollar idea. The next game we're looking at here is Formation Z, also from Jellicoe. Just like Xerion, this game is a shooter, only this one is a horizontal shooter. And much like that other game, this game just isn't very good. In fact, playing Formation Z is a grim, joyless experience. You probably will not have a very good time playing it. This game isn't all bad. It does have a few original concepts. Well, not completely original, but perhaps the first time these ideas have been used in a video game. Your character can change from a little robot running along the ground and jumping to a jet fighter. By pressing up on the D-pad while you're jumping, he will transform into a jet fighter. Now this, of course, was not something that's been invented. It had been seen in various Japanese cartoons like Robotech and, of course, Transformers. A couple more notable shooters would use this same concept in later years. Now I guess the one graphically interesting feature about this game is the fact that the screen scrolls up and down. That was sort of unusual at its time, but still a rather bland, dull-looking game. This was actually a port of a slightly earlier arcade game from Jellico, and the graphics look about the same on both versions. So ultimately, this game is not very pleasant to look at. It's repetitive and boring. And when you're in the shape of the robot running along the ground, it's kind of difficult to actually shoot the guys. To give you an idea of how much this game is lacking, this came out in February 1985. Gradius would be in arcades just about a month later. So this game was very much behind the curve when it came to other shooters. From April 1985, we have Soccer, developed by Nintendo. First of all, notice you get to choose your team here. These are just sort of generic teams representing different countries. Interestingly, they've given the players from the different nations slightly different skin tones. You also choose the skill level and the length of the halftime. We've chosen 15 minutes, but if you look at the timer, you'll see time is actually going by much faster than real time. Well, this game is certainly not bad. It's certainly a hell of a lot better than Formation Z. One technical aspect about these sorts of games is that you're not controlling an individual player, you're controlling an entire team. Most of these games have some sort of mechanism where you can switch between different players. This game is no different. The player you actually have control over is the one with a little arrow pointing to him. You can use your B button to move around from player to player, and in a case like this, you can use your D-pad to control which player you want to throw the ball to. Something that is a little confusing on this game and does hamper gameplay is the fact that the player that you have selected will change automatically depending on the proximity to the ball. This can make gameplay difficult at times, especially when the ball is being kicked around back and forth a lot. You'll find yourself controlling one team member when suddenly the control automatically switches to another member because the ball has gotten closer to him. Other than that, the game is pretty decent. This is a very basic soccer game. You use one button to kick, one button to change players. Like real soccer games, it seems often you spend a lot of time fighting back and forth for control of the ball rather than actually scoring. There are, I suppose, a couple interesting things here. For example, there is a very cute little halftime show that occurs. Likewise, when the game is over, the winners do a little dance. Other than that, I would say that soccer is an average, not outstanding, sports game. This would be the last sports game Nintendo would make for a little while. They wouldn't make another one, Volleyball, until about a year and a half from now. April 1985 sees another third-party developer making games for the Nintendo. This developer is the arcade giant Taito. And here we have their Space Invaders. This starts off pretty promisingly. Now, Taito was one of the major players in the arcade scene in the early 80s. They were a company that had been around for quite some time, since the 1950s. In the 70s, they started going into amusement games and arcade games. And in 1978, they released one of the most popular and influential video games of all time, Space Invaders. In a lot of ways, Space Invaders was the game that helped popularize video games. Now, you would think it would not be difficult for Taito to port one of their own arcade games to the Famicom, especially one that came out in 1978. It sort of recreates the original arcade intro screen there. But once you actually start playing the game, you'll realize that something is seriously wrong. The original arcade game controls very, very smoothly and is a joy to play, even in this day and age. The Famicom version, by contrast, seems sort of stiff and sluggish. For one thing, it seems that the actual Space Invaders are much harder to hit with your cannon. When you compare the two versions, the Famicom seems to have placed the actual enemies much further apart than the original arcade version. Arcade Space Invaders has a screen that's much higher than it is wide, and it seems that when converting to the wider format used by the Famicom, something was really lost in the translation here. So it seems what should have been a pretty easy conversion eventually comes across as quite a bit of a letdown. Released the same day as Space Invaders is Championship Lode Runner. The first Lode Runner was a huge hit on the Famicom, so naturally Hudson Soft ported the sequel. This looks and plays pretty much exactly like the first Lode Runner, only it's much, much, much more difficult. In fact, at first glance, this game looks virtually impossible. Only the expert Lode Runner player can really figure this out. Whereas the first Lode Runner seemed to be sort of running around avoiding the enemies, this game is a lot of time working on puzzles. For example, that little pile of gold dust right there appears impossible to get without trapping yourself on first glance, but through a clever combination of erasing blocks you can get to it. Championship Lode Runner is loaded with traps and dead ends. It is ridiculously easy to find yourself trapped with no way to get out, and a lot of the solutions are not really obvious. You can select different stages up to stage 5 when you first start playing the game. Later stages require a password. Here's an example of the typical puzzle-like levels in this game. You can't seem to get to any of those piles of gold dust without trapping yourself, and when you try to walk over to the right, you trap yourself immediately. And then the enemies come and get you, and there's no way out. On the other hand, if you simply walk over and peer onto the ledge, the enemies won't come and try to get you. Championship Lode Runner does have an option where by hitting the start button you can use the D-pad to move the camera around the room, as we did just a moment ago. So what's the solution to this? Well, you need to lure the enemies down to you by going down one level. Now, as you can see, they're advancing towards the pit. Once they've all fallen into the pit, you can safely cross over them. So if you've completely mastered the first Lode Runner or looking for a bigger challenge, by all means give it a shot. Everyone else should probably steer clear, as this game will frustrate and confuse you to no end. Our next game here is Antarctic Adventure by Konami. This is in fact the first Konami game for the Famicom. Konami originally started as a jukebox company back in the late 60s. The name Konami was actually taken from letters in the names of the three founders. By around the late 70s, they had started making video games, and in the early 80s had a string of very popular arcade titles, such as Frogger, Tutankham, Super Cobra, Track and Field, and many more. Now, once Konami had signed on to make games for the Famicom, that meant that Nintendo had three out of the four largest Japanese game developers working with them. That, of course, was Konami, Taito, and Namco. The fourth Japanese arcade giant was, of course, Sega. However, at this stage, Sega was viewing Nintendo more as competition rather than a potential partner. Sega will make a dramatic entrance into our story later this year. So, about this game. What's it like? Well, I believe that this is a port of a game Konami originally developed for the MSX in 1983. It's essentially a racing game, only you have a penguin instead of a car. Use your D-pad up and down to control the speed, left and right to control the movement. Your object is to race down a little track and get to the research laboratory at the end. In between levels, a map will plot your progress around the continent. Once you've gotten all the way around, the game starts again. This game is supposedly well remembered in Japan. This was never released in the US, and it's not bad. Almost like a cross between a racing game and a platformer because you have to jump over various obstacles, such as holes, pits. The little ice holes often have seals that pop out of them, and you will hit the seal while jumping. As a result, it often makes more sense to try to avoid holes rather than jump over them. I guess we'll call this a reasonably fun but not terribly addictive game. The same day as Antarctic Adventure, Konami released Year Kung Fu, a port of their relatively recent arcade game. Now, the original arcade Year Kung Fu was a genuinely pioneering title. In fact, it sort of set the template for all fighting games to follow. In this game, you fought a variety of opponents, usually armed with different weapons and special skills. You had a number of different attacks you can employ. This game was quite simple compared to the later fighting games such as Street Fighter. But at the time, this was completely innovative. Unfortunately, the Famicom Year Kung Fu doesn't quite live up to the same standards. In fact, it's almost a completely different game. Now, this game was also released on the MSX at around the same time. I can't help but wonder if maybe the arcade version and the home console version were developed simultaneously. First of all, you'll notice this game has an unusually horrifying color scheme. Green, red, and purple. They've also reduced the number of opponents that you face from 11 to 5. And your moveset is also very much reduced. You only have basic kicks and punches. The game is also somewhat harder to control. Of course, my personal preferences for playing ER Kung Fu in the arcade version involve a lot of jumping around. This game makes it quite a bit more difficult to jump. Additionally, the hit detection on this is a little strange. A lot of times you'll be standing right next to someone hit them and it doesn't register. This game sort of underscores a problem for the Famicom. As arcade systems became more and more advanced, the Famicom stayed the same. Year Kung Fu is really, I think, the first port of an arcade game that suffers substantially in comparison to the arcade original. The Famicom simply isn't capable of recreating this arcade game. This would become even more true in time as arcade games got graphically more and more complex and bigger and bigger. The thing is, Year Kung Fu for the Famicom is actually a lot better than something like Urban Champion. It only suffers in comparison to the original. Thank you. And from May of 1985, we have Ninja-kun by Jalico. This is a port of a 1984 arcade game that was originally by UPL. UPL is a company you might not be familiar with. They made several arcade games, but were not particularly well known. The graphics on the arcade version look more or less identical to this. The original arcade version wasn't particularly graphically sophisticated looking game, so the Famicom is able to capture it pretty accurately. Now, Ninja-kun is a series of games, this being the very first one. Jalico would continue to release them from time to time. The full title of this game is Ninja-kun Majo no Bugen, which means something along the lines of Adventure at Demon Castle. You might wonder, well, this doesn't appear to be a castle, it looks like you're on a series of cliffs. Later, you do run around on top of like a Japanese-style castle. And later, there are also things that look more like demons. These guys here look more like ninjas. So, you play this small ninja, and the object of the game is simply to kill every enemy on the level. Okay, we're about to enter the castle level. Just a warning, Demon Castle does not actually look anywhere near as cool as it sounds. Now you're armed with throwing stars. A single star will take out any enemy. However, you can also knock them out simply by running into them, like from behind, or even jumping on them from the top like you see right there. Probably the easiest way to take care of enemies is to hit them from below and then use your stars on them. One thing about this game is that the means of jumping seems a bit more complicated than it should be. You actually have to be moving to the left or the right in order to jump up a level. If you're not touching the D-pad to the left or the right and you hit the jump button, you'll actually jump down. To me, it seems it would make more sense to be able to jump up and down by hitting up or down on the D-pad, but that's not the way that Jalico chose to do it. As you can see, you're now fighting actual demons. The enemies tend to get more difficult in later levels. As far as I know, Ninja-kun has no real ending. The three levels just keep repeating infinitely. So this is certainly not a bad game. It's kind of fun to play for a little while. You probably won't gain immense satisfaction from playing it, but it certainly is a nice little time killer. Certainly much better than Formation Z. Okay, next up we have Chak and Pop from Taito. This is taken from their 1983 arcade game, which you probably won't remember wasn't exactly a huge hit as far as I know. However, if you're looking at this game and it seems kind of familiar, that's because it does in fact resemble Bubble Bobble a little bit. Taito now technically considers this game to be sort of the predecessor to Bubble Bobble. Some of the character sprites were reused in Bubble Bobble. However, one thing about Bubble Bobble is it is a whole hell of a lot more fun than this game. Not that this game is really bad, it's just nothing spectacular. You play the little yellow guy with the wings, your name is Chakin. You can crawl around the ceilings and floors, and you can also drop bombs. Those little red things are bombs. When they go off, they will destroy any monsters or eggs in the nearby vicinity. Your goal is to find the hearts that have been captured and use a bomb to free them from the cage, then get up to the top and escape the level. Along the way, you might find it very helpful to destroy eggs so that when the eggs eventually hatch, you won't be crawling the area, you won't be crawling with monsters. In that way, it also sort of resembles Bomberman a little bit. The controls of this game are a little strange. I sometimes find myself getting a little bit frustrated with the controls. There are a couple levels where it's rather difficult to sort of get where you need to be. I think there's around 10-12 levels. Once you've completed those, they simply start repeating. Apparently the main goal here is to find your girlfriend once you've completed all 10 or 12 levels. She will appear and then it will start all over again. You also have a time limit. If that little guy pushing the green egg, or whatever that is, gets all the way to the end, you will lose a life. See right there, I'm having sort of difficulty getting on a little ledge. As I mentioned, the controls can sometimes be a bit frustrating. So, while this is by no means a horrible game, it's actually kind of fun, it's more of a dry run for Bubble Bobble than anything else. Namco continues their series of classic arcade titles for the Famicom with Dig Dug. I assume you all will be familiar with this game. It was quite the popular title in the arcades back in the 80s. Your character Dig Dug goes around and uses a little pump to blow up monsters. And that's really all there is to it. This is one of those games where the simplicity of the gameplay really helps make it appealing and addictive. You have two kind of monsters, the little fellows with the goggles and the little dragons that breathe fire. They can actually travel through the dirt, occasionally turn to little transparent eyes and follow you around. Like most games of this era, it starts out simply enough. Each level, the difficulty increases until finally you run out of lives. One way of getting more points is to crush them with rocks, rather than blow them up with your pump. Also, if you drop two rocks per level, you'll get little bonus vegetables and fruit and whatnot that'll appear there. And once again, Namco wisely decided to keep the original aspect ratio of game. Taito certainly could have learned something from this when they made Space Invaders. Not much to say about this game. This looks pretty much just like the arcade version and is just a very fun little classic. Next up, we have Flappy by DBSoft. This game starts out with a rather helpful and long demonstration screen. Sort of gives you an idea how to actually play this game. Flappy is what we're going to call a Sokoban type game. Sokoban being an extremely popular Japanese computer game that is not very well known in the West. The name Sokoban means something along the lines of shopkeeper or warehousekeeper in Japanese. These games are basically where you push around objects in a maze. There's usually a certain rule such that you can only push the objects, not pull them, and you can't push more than one at a time. Just like Lode Runner, Sokoban games require an awful lot of planning and strategy. If you don't plan carefully, you can easily make a fatal error that will prevent you from finishing the level. Now, reportedly, this game Flappy is quite popular in Japan. Of course, it was never released in the United States, and is not very well known over here. You also might not be familiar with the name of the developer, DBSoft. These guys were formed around 1980, and they're primarily a computer software developer. They did release a few video games, but really nothing that's particularly noteworthy. In Japan, they're actually pretty notorious for releasing a game called 177. 177 was apparently some sort of rape simulation game that actually got pulled off store shelves by order of the Japanese government. Now, just like Hudson, DBSoft didn't really develop arcade games. They're more of a developer for Japanese computers. Flappy is a port of a game that they released for the Japanese computers originally in 1983. So at any rate, about Flappy. In this game, you control the little yellow dog-like creature, and the object of the game is to get the blue boulder on top of the blue platform. You have to clear the other boulders out of the way in order to do this, usually. Now, you can crush the boulders by stepping on them, you can roll them one at a time, and you can only push them, you can't pull them. There are also enemies to contend with. Luckily, you can find little mushroom-type things that allow you to shoot a little arrow at them and temporarily paralyze them. They can also be squashed with a rock. As I mentioned earlier, this game is about 95% strategy and planning. And it's not an easy game. A lot of levels are actually quite difficult to figure out, and you will have to put some serious thought into what you're going to do before you start moving boulders around. Once you've gotten the blue boulder onto the blue platform, you then move on to the next level. Altogether, there's 200 levels. Sokoban-type games and other strategy games that are similar are actually quite popular in Japan. So we will see several more of these sorts of games on the Famicom in the future. The Japanese seem to have a virtually insatiable appetite for this sort of thing. If you're a fan of Lode Runner and such puzzle maze-type games, you might want to check this one out. Now, here we have a rather curious little title called Wrecking Crew. This game has the distinction of being the sequel to Mario Brothers, as well as one of the least known of the Mario titles. When discussing Donkey Kong 3, I mentioned that Nintendo has the habit of making sequels that are often radically different than the original. Wrecking Crew certainly falls into this category, as it's really nothing at all like the original Mario Brothers. In the US, this game was a launch title for the NES, so it actually came out the same day as Super Mario Bros. For that reason, maybe it sort of fell into the shadow of its more famous cousin. The object of this game is to, using your sledgehammer, destroy all various destructible components of each screen. There are various stone walls, ladders, that sort of thing that need to be destroyed. Once you've destroyed everything on the screen, you move on to the next level. This goes on through 100 levels, after which the whole thing starts again, only more difficult. While doing this, make sure you dodge the various unusual-looking monsters roaming around. Now, there is one interesting feature of this game, which is that there's actually a foreground and a background. When the monsters enter the various doors, they actually switch from the foreground to the background. You can actually see their shadow roaming around, but they can't actually hurt you until they enter back into the foreground. As is standard for the Mario games, there is a bonus level. The object is to hit the little lockers until you find the coin before the other guy does. While Wrecking Crew can certainly be a fun and challenging game in places, unfortunately it doesn't really seem to fit into the rest of the Mario universe. And since it came out only a few months before Super Mario Bros., and unlike the original Mario Bros., wasn't an arcade hit, it has sort of fallen into obscurity, perhaps undeservedly. Our last game this episode is Spartan X, known as Kung Fu in the United States. This is a port of Irem's 1984 arcade game, which was known as Kung Fu Master in the US. Note the Paragon Films Limited copyright notice on the arcade version, One thing that's interesting about this is it appears to be based on the Jackie Chan, Sammo Hung, Yuen Biao film called Wheels on Meals. In Japan, this was released in theaters as Spartan X. If we examine the arcade game's title screen, we see it uses the exact same logo as the film. However, here are the similarities end. Wheels on Meals takes place in Barcelona and features a European-style castle. The video game features a Chinese environment. More than anything else, this game resembles the pagoda scene from Bruce Lee's Game of Death. In that film, Bruce Lee fights his way to the top of a pagoda, one story at a time. Each story has a different martial arts master. That's basically the plot of this game. Now what has occurred here is that you play someone named Thomas, and your girlfriend Sylvia has been kidnapped by the mysterious Mr. X. She's being held at the top of the tower, and your job is to fight your way up to the top. Now the names Thomas and Sylvia are from the movie Wheels on Meals. However, there is no Mr. X in that film. I assume what actually happened here is that Iron was already working on the game when the offer came in to tie it into Spartan X. They made a few superficial changes, like the character's name, and then released the game as is. Doesn't really seem likely, however, this game was actually inspired by the movie. Now, when this game came out in arcades, back in 1984, it seemed quite revolutionary. It actually seemed a lot different than other games that were available at that time. First of all, it seemed to have some sort of overall plot. This game presented you with a clearly defined goal, rescuing Sylvia. But unlike single-screen games like Donkey Kong, you didn't really know what was coming up ahead. You had a general idea that you had to get to the top of the five stories of the pagoda, but you really did not know what would be on those upper stories until you got to them. This helped create sort of a dramatic tension to the game. You knew you had an ultimate goal, but you had no idea what was in store for you. When you first came across the various sub-bosses at the end of each floor, they were quite a surprise. Now, Spartan X is of course considered to be perhaps the first side-scrolling beat-em-up game, but in a lot of ways it actually looks forward to Super Mario Bros. It's a side-scrolling game with a number of clearly defined levels. At the end of each level, there's sort of a sub-boss that you must defeat before moving on to the next level. Once you reach the final level, you battle the main boss, rescue the girl, and then it begins again. We're seeing Mr. X right here. Unfortunately, he's not a very imposing character, sort of a regular-looking guy with a goofy redneck haircut. This game has a couple little graphical indicators to sort of let you know what your progress is. Near the player life bar, you see a number of boxes which tell you which floor you're currently on. Also, a little dragon head lets you know how many times you've actually completed the entire game. The Famicom version remains pretty true to the arcade original. Graphics aren't quite as good, but it's close enough to certainly be a lot of fun to play. This game is, of course, very simple as compared to later beat-em-ups, and it is sort of repetitive, but at the time it came out originally in arcades, it was an immensely impressive game.